Greetings, everyone, and welcome. I'm the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone. You tune in to another edition of Soul Facts, a show highlighting the history and music of legendary artists and preserving their legacies. In this edition features one of the most beautiful, talented, soulful, rawest divas ever anointed in the world of R&B, soul, and funk. Soul Facts Spotlight artist, Marvelous Marva Whitney. Born on Monday, May 1st, 1944, in Armourdale, Kansas, a section in Kansas City, Kansas, embedded in the outskirts of Wyandotte County, Marva Ann Manny, known to the music world as Marva Whitney, uproots in music, began at the tender age of 3 in the Church of God in Christ. At age 5, Marva's first national exposure was an appearance in the February 1951 issue of Ebony, through a photo session arranged by Pet Milk, a leading milk company at the time. Marva's performing career started when she toured with a family gospel group, the Manning Singers, where her mother schooled her on perfect pitch harmony. The Manning Singers traveled for 6 years until her mother developed Bell's palsy, a stroke. The group then called it quits. Marva was one of the first sopranos in a gospel group. Around this time, Marva attended Sumner High School, but was soon expelled for fighting. She finally graduated in 1962. Whitney took odd jobs at Fashion Bill Garments and at City Hall. She even trained as a key punch operator. Marva then joined the Whitney Singers, another gospel group where she met her first husband, Harry Orlando Whitney, and got married at 18. She gave birth to her first child, Sherry. The two later divorced in 1965. In 1963, Marva joined a local group called Tommy and the Derbies, whom she met singing and venturing in other clubs. The Derbies, one of the top bands in Kansas City, opened for top artists like Ike and Tina Turner, Bobby Blue Bland, Etta James, and Dionne Warwick. After Las Vegas' successful run, someone goofed an audition on the strip, causing the group not to get the gig. So instead, they came back home to Kansas City. The Derbies soon departed afterwards. Marva met a gentleman who she'd known since her years with the Whitney Singers named Clarence Cooper. Cooper recognized the talent and soon became her manager. In 1966, Whitney got married for a second time to a white DJ that worked in the casino named Phil Waddell. Waddell was abusive towards Marva until she turned the tables on him instead and gave him a serious whipping. Meanwhile, the James Brown Show was in town to play at the Memorial Hall. Manager Clarence Cooper had clout with someone on the show who told him that they needed a female singer because their featured vocalist, Vicki Anderson, was leaving to join the Joe Tex Review. Cooper set up a meeting with Marva with Ben Bart of Universal Attractions, James Brown's booking agency. Now, the meeting was postponed because a riot had broke out during one of the performances. But fate would play its part a few months later when James Brown returned to Kansas City. Whitney auditioned for James at the Memorial Hall in May of 1967, who was scheduled to play two shows. Marva's audition was through James Brown's musical director, Alfred Pee Wee Ellis, who was carrying a tape recorder. Ellis then sat at the Hammond B3 organ and played different tunes to test Marva's ability and range, and was surprised to know that Whitney had a knowledge in music 101, calling out key signatures and changes, something she learned while playing the piano in church at the age of 12. Pee-wee took the audition tape to James Brown's dressing room. Brown was very impressed with what he heard and summoned Pee-wee to see Marva. Nervously, Whitney entered his dressing room while James was in his robe, looking in the mirror, grooming himself. Brown told Marva that she was a very good singer, and if she sounded like this on a small tape, she would be dynamite in the studio. Brown asked Whitney how would she like to work for him. Whitney gushed and said that would be wonderful. James then asked her how soon could she leave, and she replied, "Whenever you're ready, sir." Marva soon rushed home and threw a few things together to go to Cincinnati, where the show was traveling to the next day. When she told her parents about leaving with James Brown, they disapproved, but felt at ease because they knew her manager, Clarence Cooper. Eventually, Marva got a formal blessing. Marva Manning now becomes Marva Whitney, using the former married name because the Manning name represented a title of her religious beliefs and didn't look good in the church community if she used it in the music business. Marva signed with Ben Bart of Universal Attractions, although she was on the James Brown show. Through Ben Bart, Whitney inked a deal with King Records and recorded two singles, "Your Love Was Good For Me," back with "If You Love Me," and "Saving My Love For My Baby," all three recorded in 1967. "Saving My Love For My Baby, Saving My Love For My Baby." Marva went back home to Kansas to wait for the call to go on the road. It was about a month before she finally got the call for her and her manager Cooper to meet them in Cincinnati. James Brown gave her an opportunity to see how the show operated, in which marked her first 2 weeks with the review. Marva discovered that James Brown was a perfectionist and moody to a fault, and how everyone was afraid of him, except for Bobby Bennett, a member of the famous Flames and Brown's hairdresser. Marva began dating Bennett soon after, but James Brown had an eye for her as well. Whitney's first recording with James Brown was a show he recorded live at the Apollo Theater in June 24th, 25th, Saturday and Sunday in 1967, and issued as a two-record set entitled "Live at the Apollo Volume 2 in 1968 on King Records. She performed a duet with James called "Think," the revamp of the 1957 Fire Royals tune, as the opening number of the show. "Think about the good thing." It was a tough road in the beginning for Marva. She claimed that after weekend shows at Kansas City clubs, when she got with James, her first run was 31 shows in 30 days. James Brown was hotter than ever back then, and we fly one day on the plane for an afternoon job and go somewhere else for an evening show. I mean, it was tough, hellishly tough. I thought I was gonna die. We worked so hard. I felt like a trapped animal sometimes. Marva also said that they weren't allowed to call other people on the show by their first names. It was either Miss This or Mr. That. If James heard someone call me by my first name, he would correct them and say, "Excuse me, that's Miss Whitney." While on the road, Marva had an extra duty besides performing on the James Brown show. She became his road secretary and made $50 a week. He knew that one time she worked in the office and appointed her on the spot. The review traveled to Europe during the fall of 1967, playing in other places like Germany, Denmark, France, and England. Whitney said that on this trip, she felt a coldness from her fellow musicians and dancers through untrue rumors and gossip. It was also around this time, she said, that James Brown began to get close to her, showering her with expensive gifts. During a European trip, King Records reissued Marva Whitney's second single, If You Love Me, in September of 1967. Meanwhile, the review also traveled in Las Vegas for a few days. Although Marva was still dating Famous Flame member Bobby Bennett, James Brown still tried to win her affections. Marva simply put Mr. Brown in place with a few choice words on their relationship being strictly professional only. James was furious and gave her the cold shoulder. He then told her that he was sending her to Cincinnati, King Studios, to cut a few sides, and he was sending for her to come back within a couple of weeks. Little did she know, she was being replaced by singer Vicki Anderson, who also disliked Whitney. Marva went to Cincinnati and cut a few tunes and did a few shows with singer Rufus Thomas. The call from James Brown never came, so she decided to go back home to Kansas City to visit for a while. Now feeling edgy in Kansas City, Marva left town and traveled to Detroit and did a few gigs to make ends meet, since James Brown didn't pay her for the show she appeared in, even off the road. Whitney felt her career was on a halt, so her manager Cooper had a face-to-face talk with James Brown, asking to come back to the show. Brown said, "Okay, tell her when I come to Cleveland, you and she are to come and see me." As Marva predicted, James Brown broke her spirit. It was just a matter of time before he cornered her. Now, when they all met in Cleveland, James Brown sent Marva to appear on Dick Clark's American Bandstand. He also decided that Whitney needed a change in musical direction since the release of his hit Cold Sweat and issued Unwind Yourself, back with her reissue of If You Love Me in early 1968.
Unwind yourself!
Marva performed the song on American Bandstand. She also appeared as a centerfold in Jet Magazine in March 1968. After the show, James Brown sent Marva back to the hotel to pack and go back to Kansas City because he had to go to Portland, Oregon. Whitney arrived at the hotel and started packing when suddenly there was a knock on the door. It was James Brown. He expressed his no choice intentions towards Whitney, and after some small talk, it was settled. Brown made Marva Whitney his woman. She had no choice in the matter. Marva and the James Brown Review traveled the country and overseas, including Africa, where they were treated like royalty. When the review returned back to America, tragically, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated on Thursday, April 4th, 1968. The next day, the JB Review was scheduled to do a concert in Boston. All review members agreed to do it just to calm the situation down. When they got there, the atmosphere was charged and edgy. Marva that evening sang four songs: Etta James' Tell Mama, Debbie Taylor's Check Yourself, Aretha Franklin's Chain of Fools, and Gladys Knight and the Pips' Heard It Through the Grapevine. Midway through James Brown's set, fans got excited and jumped on the stage where the cops pushed them off. But Brown, unafraid, managed to calm the tense situation down and finish the show. With top press coverage of the event and James Effler's bounds, he became a hero of the movement and to Black America. Meanwhile, the King imprint issued uncharted singles on Marva Whitney, including What Kind of Man, back with her reissue of Your Love Was Good for Me in 1968.
Takes a girl's love for what he needs. Your love was good to
Gotta Get Better, Get Together, back with the reissue of What Kind of Man in 1968. I'll Work It Out, back with All My Love Belongs to You in 1968.
But I'll work it out. Just stay right here with me.
I'm Tired, I'm Tired, I'm Tired. Things Better Change Before It's Too Late, back with the reissue of If You Love Me, released in 1968.
I'm tired, I'm tired, I'm tired, I'm tired. According to faith, things better change before it's too late.
What Do I Have to Do to Prove My Love to You? Back with the 1967 reissue of Your Love Was Good for Me, issued in 1968.
What do I have to do to prove my love for you?
In May 1968, James Brown announced to the Review that they would be traveling to Korea, Japan, and Vietnam. Senator Hubert Humphrey and John H. Johnson, founder of Ebony and Jet magazine, sponsored the trip. On June 5th, Marva, along with a few of JB's entourage, took off from JFK Airport in New York, flew to Los Angeles, and then to Hawaii, where they stayed over. Then it was Seoul, South Korea, then Vietnam. Now, despite criticism, James Brown took the trip with his own costs, knowing that the black soldiers on the front line come from his community whose lives were at risk, have a right to be entertained, just like the white soldiers that sees Bob Hope's USO shows overseas. With their lives on enemy territory, Marva said that you can hear the explosions and the rattle of machine gunfire while on stage. The JB Review did two concerts a day, one in the morning and one in the afternoon, with the deadly heat and humidity in tow. Marva said that it was the most scary moment in her life. They arrived back in the U.S. on Monday, June 17th, and Marva said she wasn't sorry to leave Vietnam. It was an excruciating 2 weeks. Whitney would experience a relapse in New York while walking down the street. A portion of the Vietnam experience was featured in the 2014 bio on James Brown entitled Get On Up. Although Marva was in an intense relationship with James, she thought that the trip would bring them closer. She did say at one point that she loved and cared for him, but it got worse. Marva Whitney said that serving her country in Vietnam was the highlight of her life with James Brown. Whitney, including JB's Review, all received certificates from the Department of Defense for their services on Saturday, June 15th, 1968. Now, the second half of 1968, after Marva came back from Vietnam, she thought she was losing her mind. The constant touring and backbiting behind the scenes, combined with new abuse from James Brown, all took its toll. Whitney was debating whether to leave the Review or stay. She wanted freedom from his tyranny and the BS. Marva was tired, tired, tired. She did manage to get away one time and flew to LA and stayed at a Holiday Inn and slept for 2 days straight. She did manage to re-energize herself and return back to the Review. 1968 for Marva was an intense but interesting year. Marva Whitney also appeared on James Brown Present His Shows of Tomorrow album, issued on King Records in 1968. Two songs by Marva were added to the song's roster, If You Love Me and What Kind of Man. Whitney also recorded a few tracks with DeFelice and his trio, along with duets with James Brown. The 1966 Bobby Hebb classic hit, Sonny, later added on the James Brown Getting Down to It LP, released in 1969.
Sonny!
And You Gotta Have a Job. If You Don't Work, You Can't Eat. When released, it was back with her solo, I'm Tired, I'm Tired, I'm Tired. Things Better Change Before It's Too Late, released in 1969.
You got to have a job.
Tell it.
With one meat on the table.
You got to have a job to keep your family able.
I'm tired of working for nothing and being treated like a snob.
During the spring of 1969, the Isley Brothers were hotter than Coles with the current smash on the teenage label called It's Your Thing.
It's your thing. Do what you wanna do.
Marva said James Brown hated it because the new sound the brothers presented in the song threatened his musical popularity. Brown told Marva that she was going to do an answer song to It's Your Thing, retitled to It's My Thing. After the session, James Brown, having top access to King Records, had the record pressed within 24 hours. With Brown's powerful connections with radio stations around the country, the song sold like gangbusters. Back with a great up-tempo tune called Ball of Fire, It's My Thing charted number 19 R&B on Billboard Soul Singles on June 14, 1969. Marva, who co-wrote the song with Brown and was given writer's credits, never received any royalties. It's My Thing was Marva's first charted hit. Marva Whitney reported that the Isley Brothers were not happy when James Brown released It's My Thing because it was so close to their song It's Your Thing, and went to visit him. They had a dispute in his backyard, stating that they wanted residual royalties and writing credits. Whitney never found out if the problem was resolved or financially settled. With a hit on her hands and her travels with James Brown, Marva Whitney's popularity grew immensely, as she graced the front cover of Jet magazine with an in-depth article and interview, including pictures, entitled Marva's Musical Mission, issued on Thursday, August 21st, 1969. With a newfound popularity, Marva Whitney was awarded the Golden Mic, presented to her by the National Association of Television and Radio Announcers of Washington, D.C. Marva also made TV guest appearances. Her debut on The Joey Bishop Show, David Frost, Steve Allen, Merv Griffin, Mike Douglas, and Playboy After Dark. More Marva Whitney singles issued on King, including Things Gotta Get Better, Get Together, number 22 R&B on August 30th of 1969. I Made a Mistake Because It's Only You, Part 1 and Part 2, number 32 R&B on November 1st of 1969, Marva's last charted hit.
I made a mistake. I made a mistake.
The I Made a Mistake track was later used on Hank Ballard's 1973 single From the Love Side, released on Polydor Records.
Only you.
This Girl's in Love with You, the Herb Albert and Tijuana Brass 1968 hit, back with He's the One, released in 1969.
You see this girl?
Her last King single, It'll Work Out, back with Just Won't Do Right, issued in 1970.
I'll work it out. Somehow I know.
Two albums on Marvin Whitney were released on King. It's My Thing, produced by James Brown, featuring her past cut singles from 1967 to 1968, with the exception of two JB instrumental tracks. In the Middle, from a Soulful Christmas album released in December of 1968, and Shades of Brown, issued on his Say It Loud, I'm Black and Proud album in 1969. Marva hated it when it was released, featuring those two instrumental tracks, feeling that James Brown was trying to steal her limelight. Now, the front cover photo was taken in Nashville, Tennessee at Hal Neely's ranch, who was King Records producer. The second album by Marva was Live and Low Down at the Apollo, released in November of 1969. Marva Whitney couldn't really enjoy her musical triumphs because of her trials and tribulations with James Brown. But the straw that broke the camel's back was when Brown pulled a gun on her while they were doing a few shows in California and threatened her life. After 2.5 years with James Brown, Marva Whitney had enough and left his review in December of 1969 and went back home to Kansas. Because of the popularity of a recording of It's My Thing, the James Brown camp tried to contact her, but she wanted no part of them. The JB camp was upset, of course, because the bookings and promotions were costly and had to be canceled. Marva didn't care, although she was looking over her shoulder in fear of James Brown because of his power. Marva Whitney tried to find work outside the JB organization, was very difficult, but lucked up on some people that wanted to help her. The Isley Brothers were among the first to gain interest. Marvin went to Chicago and recorded Two Sides, released on their T-Neck label in 1971, Giving Up on Love and This Is My Quest. Not receiving the proper promotion from the record company, the song died a certain death. It is now considered a record collector's gem. Marva left and never recorded for the Isley Brothers again. After the T-Neck Isley Brother fiasco, Marva Whitney got with musician Ellis Taylor, founder of Soul and Funk Forte Records, and issued a single entitled Daddy Don't Know About Sugar Bear, back with We Need More, But Somebody's Gotta Sacrifice in 1972, but was picked up for national distribution by Excello Records, distributed by the Nashville imprint. After divorcing Phil Waddell, she married Ellis Taylor and bore a son.
This thing, I mean, I'm trying to hold up, but you know, what am I gonna hold up to?
Hey, you out there.
Two more singles on the Forte imprint by Marva were Hey You and You and You and You, I Lived the Life, back with Nothing I'd Rather Be Than Your Weakness in 1975, under the name Marva W. Taylor, later reissued under Marva Whitney Taylor.
Nothing, nothing, nothing.
and All Alone I Loved You, back with Get Ready for the Changes, titled as Marvin and Melvin with the MWT Express in 1977.
Oh, everywhere the world, get ready for the changes.
Marvin Whitney later divorced Ellis Taylor in 1977 and relocated in Los Angeles for the next 15 years. In 1978, Marvin Whitney joined the Platters and took over the role of Zola Taylor, the group's original female singer. Whitney stayed with the group for 3 years. During the 1980s, Marva attended West Los Angeles Junior College to study business administration. She relocated to Las Vegas in 1982 and formed a girl group called Coffee, Cream, and Sugar with an old friend, Alfred Pico Payne, who performed with the Inkspots. Whitney occasionally also performed with James Brown band members, Maceo Parker, Fred Wesley, Pee Wee Ellis, and her dear friend and sister, Lynn Collins, as the JB All-Stars. She left Las Vegas and moved back to Kansas City in 1984 and married her fourth husband, a preacher named Dr. Clarence Lawrence Charles Irwin, in 1985. Unable to deal with his constant jealousy, she divorced him in 1990. Marva once again tried her hand in matrimony and married her fifth and last husband, J.J. Jones, a former schoolmate that only lasted 3 years. In 2006, Marvin Whitney collaborated with DJ manager DJ Parry and Japanese funk orchestra Osaka Monorail to produce a new single entitled I Am What I Am, Part 1 and 2, including a self-titled CD on Freestyle Records. Osaka Monorail patterned themselves on the authentic James Brown JB sound produced on Marva in 1969. On Christmas Day in 2006, the music world lost James Brown, who died from complications of pneumonia and congestive heart failure. Marva Whitney was sad, but remember what Brown did for her and her career without hatred or bitterness. Her and Brown did reunite in 1994. That same year, Marva Whitney had two successful tours in Japan. In 2007, 2008, and 2009, Marva's tours were brought to Europe, where she maintained a huge cult following.
Baby, I'm on the right track.
In December 2009, Marva Whitney suffers a stroke on stage during a concert in Lauren, Australia, while performing the Transatlantics at Falls Festival. The remaining dates were canceled. She did, however, perform again in 2010 when she made a partial recovery. But sadly, on Friday, December 22nd, 2012, Marva Whitney passed away from complications of pneumonia at her home in Kansas City. She was 68 years old. Before her passing, Marva Whitney was preparing her memoirs to write an autobiography on her life and career with James Brown. Whitney worked jointly with author Charles Waring And through exchanged phone conversations and written reminiscence through emails, the result was a fascinating, intense book entitled Marva Whitney, Memoirs of a Funky Diva, God, the Devil, and James Brown, released in May of 2013. Now, although issuing a book on her life story was a dream come true for Marva, sadly, she never lived to see it published. The difficulty when released was its non-existent promotion in 2013, plus its publishing company, Bankhouse, went out of business in 2014 and laid into obscurity. That is, until its reissuing in 2020. It is a must-read story on the great diva for music fans the world over. Dubbed Soul Sister Number 1 by Soul Brother Number 1 and mentor James Brown, Marva Whitney's gifted vocals is considered by funkologists as raw, brass, uplifting, and soulful. That describes her qualities as a great diva, honoring her true artistry during the genesis of funk music in the late 1960s. Let's just be thankful that the music outlives the diva. Until we meet again, musically soul fans, I am the Chancellor of Soul.
It's my thing. I can do what I want to do. You can tell me who to talk to.
Soul Facts, a show written, created, produced, and copywritten by the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone. Soul Facts is a nonprofit music presentation.